everyone. It's my honor to welcome you all in the second edition of Orange City Literature Fest organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation. I, Apoorva Ahuja, will be the anchor for this session, and the topic of this session is Ramayana, the Game of Life. The guest of this session is Shubh Vilas. Shubh Vilas is a TEDx speaker, lifestyle coach, storyteller, and author. He studied patent law after completing his engineering degree, but finally chose the path of a spiritual speaker. Ramayana, the Game of Life is his best-selling series. He is also the author of Open-Eyed Meditation, Mystical Tales for a Magical Life, and Perfect Love, 5.5 Ways to a Lasting Relationship. The focus of his work is the application of scriptural wisdom to day-to-day life and addressing the needs of corporates and the youth through thought-provoking seminars. He has delivered more than 5,000 talks, inspiring more than 25,000 people across 20 countries in last 10 years. He is also a visiting faculty at several premier business management schools in India, including the Indian Institute of Management, IIM, and NMIMS, Mumbai. He has also been a guest speaker at the prestigious Masculate Institute of Technology, MIT, Boston, Dresden International University, Germany, WITS, Johannesburg, and several centers of Indian Institute of Technology in India. He travels across the globe counseling and guiding student and corporate houses on leadership, overcoming failures, and managing stress among the concerned. Arun Anand will be the moderator of this session. Arun Anand is an author and journalist who has authored 6 books so far, including bestsellers Know About RSS and The Saffron Search, Untold Story of RSS Leadership. His latest book was on Ram Janmabhoomi, Truth, Evidence, Faith, which has co-authored. He is founder, editor of research and reference website www.thenationalistview.com. He is also research director at Delhi-based think tank Vichar Vinimay Kendra. Handing this session to you, Arun Anand.
Over to you. You're on mute, sir.
जी नमस्कार, आप सबका स्वागत है एंड वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू। एंड शुभ विलास जी, आपका बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। मैं सबसे पहले आपसे सीधा एक सवाल ये पूछना चाहूंगा कि व्हाट इंस्पायर्ड यू टू राइट दिस सीरीज एंड देन वी विल टॉक अबाउट द रेस्ट।
आई एम अ पार्ट ऑफ अ स्कूल कॉल्ड गोपाल्स गार्डन हाई स्कूल व्हिच इज बेस्ड इन मुंबई एंड आई यूज्ड टू टीच वैल्यू एजुकेशन एंड यू नो अ लॉट ऑफ cultural based subjects over there, and I just happened to visit the library of the school and I saw what the children are reading, and when I went through the library I saw hundreds of books there, but I couldn't find one single book that had stories and concepts from the Indian scriptures in a way that kids can actually absorb. That's when I realized. So I started saying, you know, they're reading Hardy Boys, they're reading Nancy Drew, they're reading so many other books, Harry Potter. And I was thinking, why are they not reading Ramayana and Mahabharata? And that's when I realized that instead of blaming somebody and blaming, you know, people, I said, let me write something that the kids may want to read. A version that is simple, authentic, but at the same time reads like a novel that any young child will be inspired to read. And with that in my mind, I began writing. And my only desire was that the next generation gets access to the Ramayana in a way that is not just exciting, but also enlightening.
Now, coming back to this, you have put it very beautifully. And in fact, I agree with you that in our country, especially children and adolescents, when you are a child, you have nothing beyond, you know, Amar Chitra Katha. And earlier, you used to have Chanda Mama and some other magazines, but that have also closed off. So there's not much stuff to basically read. So either you are reading Panchtantra, or and then when you become an adolescent, so there's hardly any stuff which you can read there. As so you have to go to Hardy Boys and, you know, the Nancy Drews. So I think that's an amazing, and it's very difficult, especially it's very easy to write relatively for in a genre where the adults are reading it, but to write in a genre where the kids or the adolescents are reading it, as a span of attention is much less, and the sensibilities are quite different, and you are writing as an adult. So to go back and sit into the, and times have changed when you were an adolescent, and now the current generation of adolescents or kids. So it's an altogether sea change. So how did you, you know, synchronize that thought process? I would like, especially, you know, for all those viewers and listeners who are budding writers, it would be a great insight in terms of the process, that creative process of writing.
I very strongly believe that if you really want to touch your audience, you have to be in touch with them in real. So it's not just about writing for a particular audience in your mind. So for me, when I write, my target audience always is young Indians who have intelligent to absorb deeper aspects of knowledge. So they're not just wanting to read entertainment, but they, along with entertainment, they want enlightenment also. So that's always in my mind as my target audience. So the way I am able to connect with that target, and the good part is I can tell you thousands of young readers from across the world who have reached out to me saying that they've been reading the books and super inspired by it, you know. So that I find that to be very satisfying whenever I find a youngster reaching out to me and actually thanking me for writing it, you know. I have children from as far as Slovenia and as far as, you know, so many other countries, middle of Africa and, you know, and so many places in the US reading it, and India, of course, thousands of people in India. What I do is I spend a substantial amount of time and energy talking, dealing, speaking, and engaging with these youngsters. And because I'm able to do it, and that's why the language that I'm speaking is very much something that they can connect with and they can handle. Because that's the language I speak to them in, you know, and that's the language they converse to me in. So that's the language I write the book in.
But why only Ramayana? You know, because the general perception has been that Mahabharata is many more books, much more has been written about Mahabharata. It's a more action-packed, you know, kind of the story has got more punch, and Ramayana seems to be, you know, a very slow paced kind of a thing, not much of action. And also the more important thing is that there's still many aspects of Mahabharata which are still relatively unknown and less discussed in the especially when it comes to the world of publishing or books. Whereas as far as Ramayana is concerned, so everybody thinks, you know, that okay, every year we go, we have watched the Ram Leela, we have watched that Ramanand Sagar serial also. Then there have been many versions of that serial. There is a Ramcharitmanas part in everybody's house. So it's like, you know, we know each and everything about this Ramayana. So what is there new to be told, or in present context? Why, given this context, why and what inspired you to choose Ramayana for writing?
Thank you for this question. The question itself is amazing. I'll answer this question in three parts. So the first part is the good news that I am working on a Mahabharata series in coming ahead. So I just completed the Ramayana series. So my next focus is going to be the Mahabharata. So that's the good news. The reason I chose Ramayana primarily is because I have been very inspired by the Ramayana from my younger days. I remember as a young child, you know, when I used to visit my my village, you know, basically all my every single holiday of my school days, when we used to go to the village and we used to sleep, all cousins and all young children sleep together with our grandmother. Our grandmother would always tell us Ramayana in the night. So I have heard the Ramayana from my grandmother like hundreds of times. So that has been a very strong impression in my mind, which naturally attracted me towards writing the Ramayana. And from a deeper aspect, why I wrote the Ramayana, I'll give you an example to help you understand this. When you go to people's houses, so the Ramayana tells us what is the ideal standard. Mahabharata tells us what is a real standard. That means the Mahabharata tells us what is our reality today, and the Ramayana tells us what should be our standard ideally. Just like, Mahabharata actually gives you an inner picture. It actually exposes you to who you are. Just like if you are sick or if you go to a doctor, and sometimes the doctor tells you to do an x-ray. So if you have seen an x-ray of yourself, it's a very scary picture. Just seeing the bones and, you know, the structure of our body, it's very scary, right? Have you ever seen anyone putting the x-ray on the wall? This is my inside picture. You'll never find anybody putting the x-ray on the wall. What do they put on the wall? They put the picture of the family with everyone dressed up nicely with a big smile on the face and all that. That is Ramayana. So that's the standard we want to reach. You know, that is where we want to go. But if you actually see people's houses, that smiling picture on the wall with the whole family sitting together and perfectly posed and well-dressed and all, does it ever happen in anybody's house? In house, the reality is Mahabharata. Everybody is fighting, you know. There's a war going on. Everyone is fighting against everybody else. So the reality is Mahabharata, but the standard is Ramayana, basically. So all of us, our lives are right now in Mahabharata, but we want to go towards Ramayana. So I first wrote Ramayana to help people understand what is the ideal standard that we're supposed to set. Then I'm writing Mahabharata to help us understand what is the reality we have to deal with and how to bridge the gap to reach there.
So how did you approach the subject? In the sense that, of course, we have said, but there have been many versions of Ramayana. In fact, you know, there have been even many versions of Ramcharitmanas. So, and then you have, you know, in South India also you have many versions. So which were the versions which you referred to? So how did you source your information? What were your reference sources? How did you choose them to ensure that there is authenticity? And in addition to this, if you can, people who really want to go into a little more detail in terms of studying Ramayana, so if you can also suggest a few texts after reading your books, if somebody wants to go a little deeper into this thing. So some of the basic texts, if you can suggest to our viewers. So I think that's okay.
Thank you. So my base always is Valmiki Ramayana. So my base reference has been Valmiki Ramayana. So I usually read Gita Press, Gorakhpur, the Hindi version of Valmiki Ramayana, which is, in my understanding, very authentic and quite well done. And so basically, because I have access to Sanskrit, and I have been in touch with, during my stay in the monastery, I've been in touch with Sanskrit language. So I can pick up quite a lot of the understanding of what the verses, original verses actually mean. So my base is Valmiki Ramayana. Over that base of Valmiki Ramayana, I add analogies from Kamba Ramayana, which is a Tamil, version of Ramayana. I am a Tamilian by birth, so that I have a very strong connection with the Tamil language. So I heard so many of the Acharyas of the Shivaishnava Sampradaya speak in Tamil, and I have absorbed that. And in addition to that, I also refer to Ramchandra Manas of Tulsidas Ji, where I take analogies from poetic expressions of Tulsidas. So poetic expressions of Tulsidas and Kamba put together with the base of Valmiki Ramayana. And on top of that, I add commentaries from many Acharyas. So I connect with Acharyas of the Sri Sampradaya, Govindaraj Ji, Appalya Acharya Ji, so many Acharyas of Sri Sampradaya who give very detailed commentaries on every aspect of the Ramayana. Ramanujacharya, in fact, was one of the, he heard the Ramayana from his guru, Sri Shaila Purana, almost 24 times. Different explanations and very in-depth analysis of the Ramayana. Rishi Sampradaya is very rich in Ramayana. So that is my source of commentaries for the Ramayana. In addition to that, from Ayodhya, there is Ramkumar Kinkarji, whose commentaries are like so very deep on the Ramayana. So all this put together, along with that, there has been my understanding of the stories, from how to make the stories relevant to today's life, you know. So I derive lessons which are my understanding of the storyline. All this put together is what my book series is, essentially.
Now, you have put it. So I just want to ask a basic question. Do you think that it is important that one needs to learn Sanskrit, actually, if one really needs to understand Ramayana? And because there's another thing that I think the Sanskrit which is taught today, and the Sanskrit which has been written in, you know, the ancient texts. So that's also, I think you would be able to dwell more light on that. Is there a significant difference? And if one needs to go to start learning Sanskrit, and if one has to do that, so where can one start if one has left the school? If you can throw some light on that.
So basically, Sanskrit is an ocean. You know, there is no end to, you know, how much Sanskrit you can know and understand. And no matter how many years you spend on studying Sanskrit, it will never be enough for you to be able to say that you have mastered Sanskrit. It's like the scriptures, you know. Every time you understand it, there is more to it, basically. So I do not feel that to study the scriptures, you 100% have to have access to Sanskrit language. But you definitely need access to very good, authentic commentaries and translations of the original. That is when you can be comfortable that you will understand the original text. Unfortunately, today there are a lot of people who misinterpret and misconstrue the original teachings, and therefore we speak about parampara. That means when knowledge is come down in a disciplic succession, that knowledge can be considered to be authentic knowledge. And that knowledge can be considered to be not misinterpreted knowledge. So because fortunately I have had the access to a parampara which is very bona fide, the Brahma Madhva Gaudiya parampara. And because I was born in the Sri Vaishnava Sampradaya, which is again a very powerful parampara. So the combination of these two paramparas have given me access to knowledge that is, without twisting, basically. So everybody has access to this. So it is not that only somebody who is a part of these paramparas has access. Anybody who is interested in knowledge has access to these sources of information and knowledge. So I would say that if you do not know Sanskrit, stick to a parampara. Find a parampara that is authentic, and then you will get access to knowledge, basically. So this, the way our the ancient texts have been preserved, they have been preserved by the disciplic succession, basically. That is the most important, what in the Gita, Krishna calls it Rajarishi Parampara, basically. Evam Parampara Praptam Imam Rajashayo Vidu. So that is the way in which knowledge is preserved in Indian context here.
See, now coming to the relevance of, it's very interesting, you know, Ramayana still remains. It's actually interesting for those who are not part of the Indian cultural or socio-cultural fabric. So they find it amazing that for thousands of years the parampara of Ramayana it has been there, and Ramayana still remains at the core of the Indian civilization. And so coming to a little bit in terms of the present context, what are the lessons, especially in this post-COVID, I won't say even actually post-COVID, I would say that it's still going on, but the world has undergone a significant change, it seems at least, and the way we are going to live or the way we are living is never going to be same. That is what is generally said by observers and commentators. So I just want to first, has there, because you have studied the ancient texts so deeply, has there ever been a situation like this, what we are facing right now? One. And second is that, what are the lessons? So there are three questions. One is, has there ever been a situation like this? Second, what are the lessons which in general, common people, people like us, who are basically, you know, living a normal life, so they can draw from who are living with their family, friends. So जिसके आप ये कहते हैं कि जो ग्रंथ जीवन में या जो आप एक रोजमर्रा की जिंदगी में जो है 99 के फेर में पड़े हुए जो लोग हैं, तो ऐसे लोग जो है वो क्या लेसन जो है इससे सबक सीख सकते हैं रामायण से, इस कठिन परिस्थिति में अपना संतुलन बनाए रखने के लिए और एक सकारात्मक ऊर्जा बनाए रखने के लिए। और तीसरा ये है कि जो कॉर्पोरेट्स है, जो इकोनॉमी के बारे में बहुत चर्चा हो, तो हमारे जो कॉर्पोरेट, बिकॉज यू डिलीवर दिस थिंग, तो विच आर द लेसन्स विच द कॉर्पोरेट इंडिया और द पॉलिसी मेकर्स स्पेशली इन द फील्ड ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स दे कैन ड्रॉ फ्रॉम रामायण? तो ये तीन सवाल।
थैंक यू। आपके सारे सवाल जो है इतने गहरे हैं कि थोड़ा सा गहराई में आंसर देना पड़ेगा। आपका पहला सवाल जो है कि ऐसा कोई कॉन्टेक्स्ट हुआ है क्या पहले? आई वुड इमीडिएटली ब्रिंग टू योर प्रेजेंस अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एपिसोड द रामायण दैट एक्चुअली इज वेरी क्लोज टू व्हाट वी आर एक्सपीरियंसिंग राइट नाउ। द फर्स्ट लॉकडाउन दैट हैपेंड इन द वर्ल्ड इज मदर सीता दैट गॉट लॉक डाउन इन लंका फॉर ऑलमोस्ट 10 months। So she was just locked down in one small place in four walls of the Ashoka Vatika, and you know, so many people were making sure that, you know, she doesn't get out from there and nobody gets in from there. So very much what we went through in the last, you know, 9-10 months. And the interesting part is this is the period in which the lockdown also happened, interestingly, because Chaturmas, just before the Chaturmas, which is before the rainy season, Sita got kidnapped. So somewhere in April, May, somewhere she got kidnapped by Ravan. And throughout that whole 9-10 months, which we are right now in the middle of, you know, this is the duration on which she was there in Lanka. So we can very much empathize with what Sita went through. Of course, the difference is that Sita was alone. She didn't even have a family. She didn't even have friends. She was in the middle of absolutely nowhere. You can say she was quarantined for 10 months, you can say. But the inspiration that we can learn from Sita is, in spite of being in, surrounded by negative energy, there were 700 demonesses who were constantly trying to tell her that forget Ram, Ram is not going to come to help you. Only Ravan exists, Ram doesn't exist. And constantly they were trying to better her down mentally. But Sita, in the middle of those 9-10 months that she struggled alone, she kept telling herself and reminding herself by chanting the names of Ram. She in fact kept two flowers on two sides of her. And these flowers, you know, there was these beautiful Ashoka flowers, which have a shape. If you have seen the flowers, they actually have a whirl in between. And there was a small stick that projects out in a stimuli type of thing. And that actually looks like a bow. So Sita kept two flowers on two sides of her, one representing Ram and one representing Lakshman. And she felt intensely that Ram, Lakshman are going to protect me. And they are there with me all the time. So that is how Sita kept herself sane. She kept herself hopeful. And she kept herself inspired in spite of being alone, in spite of being in an atmosphere which is filled with negativity. As far as today's context is concerned and how we can learn from it, from the Ramayana, I would like to bring out a very beautiful episode from the Ramayana that actually helps us understand this. When Ram was called to the palace of Dasharatha Maharaj, and he was given the news that he's going to be exiled for 14 years, the way Ram dealt with this is very interesting. It is explained that When Ram entered into the palace of Kaikeyi and Dashara, he had no idea what is going to happen. In fact, he was going to become the king of Ayodhya that very morning. But when he was told by Kaikeyi that you have to go for 14 years to exile in Dandakaranya forest and Bharat is going to become the king instead of you, what Ram spoke is just so amazing. And this is the way we can handle negativity in our lives. We can handle bad news in our life. We can handle all kinds of negative situations in our lives. Ram tells Kaikeyi, thank you. I was waiting for such an opportunity. He said, I was always wanting to go to the forest and study from the sages. And these 14 years are not 14 years of exile for me, but they're actually 14 years of upgradation for me. So I'm actually going to spend 14 years learning, gaining knowledge. So just like, when sometimes crows, a group of crows attack an eagle. Now, eagle is so huge and the crows are so small comparatively, you know. Now, if an eagle attacks the crows, the eagle can kill the crows very easily. But when a group of crows attack the eagle never tries to fight with them. You know what the eagle does? It just flies higher. The eagle flies so high that the crows can't reach only to him. So that is the way in which great people like Lord Ram deal with negativity. They just rise higher than the negative atmosphere that is being created. Kaikeyi created a negative atmosphere, but Ram looked at it from such a different perspective. He said it's 14 years of learning for him, and he just walked out. And that is the way in which we also have to deal with negativity in our lives when it comes. As far as the corporates are concerned, there are so many amazing things on leadership that we can learn from the Ramayana. Ramayana is a book of leadership. It teaches us the art of leadership. Ramayana teaches us. So from Ramayana's perspective, leadership means a responsibility. Responsibility means sacrifice, and sacrifice means crime. So in the Ramayana, you'll find all of the people who are leaders are crying many times, because they're making sacrifices on a personal level. So when leaders make sacrifices on a personal level, the followers can laugh. Followers can be happy. And when the leaders are laughing, the followers are supposed to make sacrifices. So today's world, the situation today is that the leaders are expecting followers to make sacrifice after sacrifice. And they are happy. And the followers are all miserable, basically. Ramrajya is about how leaders take up sacrifices on their own. And for the sake of the country, for the sake of people, for the sake of the citizens, they make tremendous sacrifices. And that's what leadership is in essence. I'm going to speak about one small concept of the Ramayana that brings out such amazing concepts of leadership that corporates can actually learn from. The kingdom of Ayodhya has a model of leadership, governance, which is very interesting. And in this model of governance, there's a very interesting concept that they have that they adopt, where they have 8 ministers. Each minister is responsible for a department. Interestingly, in Ayodhya, the name of the minister and the name of his department coincide. So the minister's name is exactly the department he's handling. So, I mean, there are so many ministers. There's a minister called Drishti. So the role of the minister is to give vision to the city of Ayodhya. He's supposed to give vision. That's what Drishti also means, farsightedness. There's another minister called Vijaya. He conquers kingdoms. So he's a chief of the army, basically. So like that, there is one particular ministry which I found to be very interesting in Ayodhya. And the minister's name is Akopa. The word Kopa, Akopa means the one. Akopa means not having grief or having no sorrow, basically. That's what Akopa means. The entire department of this minister, the whole ministry is meant to go and hear people's problems. So imagine, they have an entire department, entire ministry, only to hear grievances of people. And this is an active ministry. And this ministry was so powerfully functional in the Ram era that actually no one in the entire country had problems, because people would actually, the ministers would actually go and ensure that everybody's problems are heard. So people don't need solutions to the problems of life. They actually need someone to hear their problem. to understand their problem. Because not all problems can be solved. But if, like, when people come to me for counseling many times, you know, and I'm just sitting and hearing them, what they are going through and what they are. And after an hour or 2 hours of hearing what they're going through, they tell me, thank you very much, you solved our problem. Most of the time, I've not even opened my mouth. And people feel I've solved their problem, you know. Actually, that's why I said, people don't need solutions to the problems of life. They need someone who can sit and hear them. They need someone who can understand them. And I find that to be such a powerful contribution in the Ramayana, where you have an entire department meant for that.
Very well put, Shubhraji. Now, see, another, we have a couple of questions from the audience and the viewers also. And Purva has sent me those questions in the chat box. So I would kind of sum up these questions and try to, you know, because of the paucity of time, try to make get an essence of these questions. So, see, broadly, the questions are focused on this thing that, okay, there are certain values, which are the certain values which we require to live in present day's life, which you have identified, which we can draw from Ramayana. But the point is that how we ensure that we draw this inspiration. Because, you know, especially what has happened over with this boom in social media and the span of attention getting less and less, and life becoming just, you know, career kind of a thing. जैसे कि वो कहा जाता है कि ये बड़ी अजीब सी बात हो गई है कि बच्चों से अगर आप पूछते हैं कि तुम्हारी जिंदगी का उद्देश्य क्या है, तो वो ये कहते हैं डॉक्टर बनना है, इंजीनियर बनना है। ये आपका करियर हो सकता है, लेकिन ये आपकी जिंदगी का उद्देश्य कैसे हो सकता है? तो ये इसको ये सुनिश्चित करना कि वो राम कृष्ण, खासकर रामायण से जो है, चूंकि हम आज उसके बारे में बात कर रहे हैं, आपने एक प्रयास किया है इसका, और लेकिन ये चैलेंज इतना बड़ा है, कैसे समाज इसको ले सकता है, हाउ द सोसाइटी एज अ सोसाइटी, बट वी नीड टू डू टू इंश्योर दैट वी कंटिन्यू टू ड्रॉ इंस्पिरेशन, आर किड्स, आर कमिंग जनरेशन, दे कंटिन्यू टू ड्रॉ द इंस्पिरेशन फ्रॉम आइकन्स लाइक यू नो श्री राम, श्री कृष्ण, व्हाट डू वी नीड टू डू ऑन ग्राउंड।
मेरे अंदाज से जो सबसे प्रामाणिक और सबसे महत्वपूर्ण चीज हम सबको करना है वो है दोहराना है। जैसे पुराने जमाने में, एटलीस्ट 50 साल पहले, हम देखते हैं कि हर गांव में रामलीला होता था, ड्रामास होते थे, और हर गांव में एक जगह होता था जहां पे सब लोग इकट्ठा होके राम कथा चलता था रोज। मैं कुछ दिन पहले बहुत सारे बच्चों को मिलता रहता हूँ, तो मैं कुछ दिन पहले साउथ मुंबई में कुछ बच्चों को मिल रहा था। मैंने उनको पूछा पांडव कितने हैं, तो एक सोच रहा है, एक बोल रहा है कि 7 है, तो एक बोल रहा है नहीं नहीं 100 है, तो वो झगड़ा करने लगे 100, और कोई भी 5 नहीं बोल रहा है। तो मैं उनको ऐसे ही पूछ रहा हूँ, कुछ सवाल मैं ऐसे ही पूछ लिया था, तो उससे मेरे को समझ में आया कि इनको कोई एक्सपोजर नहीं है, लेकिन उनको आप चाइनीज माइथोलॉजी का कोई भी कैरेक्टर पूछो, बार बार बताएंगे आपको, ग्रीक माइथोलॉजी कोई भी कैरेक्टर पूछो, वो सही में बताएंगे, और ऐसे ऐसे चीज बताएंगे जो आपको जीवन में मालूम भी नहीं था। क्यों? क्योंकि एक्सपोजर उतना उसमें है, उतना उनको एक्सपोजर मिल रहा है। तो इसलिए मेरा ये अनुभव है, मेरा ये सोच है कि हम जितने तरीके से बच्चों को रामायण महाभारत के तरफ उनको एक्सपोज कर सके, या तो कथा के माध्यम से, या ड्रामास के माध्यम से, या कार्टून्स के माध्यम से, या एनिमेशन के माध्यम से, या मूवीज के माध्यम से, कितने भी माध्यम से, आजकल ऑडियो बुक्स के माध्यम से। तो मेरे सारे बुक्स जो है रामायण के, द गुड न्यूज इज दैट सारे ऑडियो बुक्स बन चुके हैं, तो ऑडिबल में अवेलेबल है। और मैं, और आजकल बहुत सारे बच्चे जो है नॉवल्स पढ़ रहे हैं। हमारी खुशकिस्मती ये है कि एटलीस्ट थोड़ा सा नॉवल्स पढ़ने का जो कल्चर है वो गया नहीं अभी तक, क्योंकि अपना सारे स्कूल्स जो है एम्फोसाइज करते हैं कि इंग्लिश बुक्स पढ़ना चाहिए ताकि लैंग्वेज इंप्रूव हो सके, ताकि आपका जो अंडरस्टैंडिंग इंप्रूव। तो वोकैबुलरी इंप्रूव करना है, लैंग्वेज इंप्रूव करना है, तो पढ़ना तो पड़ेगा ही। तो अगर पढ़ना है तो बुक्स तो चाहिए ही। तो इसीलिए जितना हम बुक्स इस तरीके से लिखेंगे जो एक युवा पीढ़ी उसको ग्रहण कर सके और उसमें इंटरेस्ट ला सके, तब जाके हम उतना एक्सपोजर ला पाएंगे। जैसे मैंने एक सीरीज लिखी, रामायण द गेम ऑफ लाइफ सीरीज तो एक है, मैंने एक किताब लिखा मिस्टिकल टेल्स फॉर मैजिकल लाइफ। ये किताब मैंने हैरी पॉटर का एक सेक्शन मैंने पढ़ा, बिकॉज मैं देख रहा था बच्चे इतने पढ़ रहे हैरी पॉटर, मैं जानने की कोशिश कर रहा था उसमें क्या रुचि है उनको। तब पता चला मुझे कि हैरी पॉटर में मैजिक है, ऐसे ऐसे चीजें हैं जो हो ही नहीं सकता, मिस्टिकल चीजें हैं और अनबिलीवेबल चीजें हैं। तो मैंने कहा ये ऐसे चीजें हमारे शास्त्रों में भी होंगे, तो मैंने रिसर्च चालू किया। मुझे एक नहीं दो नहीं, मेरे को 11 ऐसे स्टोरीज मिले और बहुत सारे और भी है। तो मैंने 11 ऐसे स्टोरीज को इकट्ठा किया जो सबसे पागल स्टोरीज है, मोस्ट मैजिकल, मोस्ट मिस्टिकल, मोस्ट अनबिलीवेबल स्टोरीज। आई पुट देम टुगेदर इन अ बुक कॉल्ड मिस्टिकल टेल्स फॉर अ मैजिकल लाइफ। तो ये किताब कोई पढ़ेगा बच्चा तो बोलेगा हैरी पॉटर का बाप है प्रैक्टिकली। तो अगर हमको मिस्टिसिज्म चाहिए तो है हमारे शास्त्रों में, अगर आपको लर्निंग्स चाहिए तो है हमारे शास्त्रों में, अगर आपको लीडरशिप के बारे में चाहिए है हमारे शास्त्रों में, आपको कुछ भी चाहिए तो हमारे पास है। बट किस तरीके से प्रस्तुत करना है इन अ वे दैट द यंगर जनरेशन कैन अंडरस्टैंड एंड अप्रिशिएट। सो दैट्स माय होल एफर्ट, आई एम ट्राइंग टू पुट इट इन अ वे दैट द नेक्स्ट जनरेशन कैन अप्रिशिएट, बिकॉज हम तो निकल जाएंगे, वी विल बी गॉन इन सम टाइम, बट वी वॉन्ट लीव अ लेगेसी बैक। दैट्स वॉट द गोल ऑफ लाइफ इज, लीव अ लेगेसी दैट कैन लास्ट बियॉन्ड अस एंड प्रिजर्व द कल्चर दैट द ऋषिज, द ग्रेट सेजेस हैव प्रिजर्व्ड सो स्ट्रांगली।
मैं शुभराज जी आपके साथ बातचीत बहुत अच्छी रही, मुझे लगता है कि अपूर्वा अगर मैं ठीक हूँ तो हमारे पास 3 से 5 मिनट और बाकी है, am I right? मैं एक क्विक सवाल आपसे जो है पूछना चाहता हूँ, और उससे पहले उसके बाद क्लोजिंग कॉमेंट्स अपूर्वा जो है, तो जैसे कि औपचारिकता धन्यवाद देने की रहती है, हालांकि धन्यवाद हमें देना चाहिए कि इतनी अच्छी बातचीत करने का आपसे मौका मिल रहा है, वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग कॉन्वर्सेशन। मैं थोड़ा क्विकली एक चीज बता देता हूँ, जैसा कि शुभराज जी ने कहा अपने व्यूअर्स के लिए, एक राइटर हुए देवकी नंदन खत्री जिन्होंने चंद्रकांत और संतति नाम के उपन्यास लिखे, जैसे उन्होंने कहा कि हैरी पॉटर। तो अगर आप चंद्रकांत और संतति पढ़ेंगे, आप विलास जी की जो पुस्तक है वो पढ़ेंगे, चंद्रकांत और संतति 20वीं शताब्दी के शुरू में, जब पिछली जो है अर्ली 20th सेंचुरी में, लोग बनारस में जब वो छपने के लिए जाती थी तो प्रिंटिंग प्रेस के बाहर 3 दिन पहले टेंट लगा के सो जाया करते थे कि सुबह छपेगी तो वो किताब लेनी है, और उस किताब को पढ़ने के लिए लोगों ने हिंदी सीखी, ये उस किताब का बोल है। वो बात अलग है कि उसका थोड़ा सा जो है वो टीवी में सीरियल में जब एडेप्टेशन हुआ तो वो बहुत खराब एडेप्टेशन हुआ शायद इस वजह से, बट वी हैव दी प्रीडिसेसर, उससे भी पहले जैसे शुभ विलास जी ने कहा एक पूरी परंपरा है हमारे यहाँ पे जो है मिस्टिकल राइटिंग की, और ऐसा नहीं है कि सब भजन पूजन और सब बड़ा बोरियत भरा है जो है, वो भी वैसे बोरियत भरा नहीं है, लेकिन फिर भी अगर युवाओं को ये लगता है तो रहस्य रोमांच हर चीज है अपने आप पे अपने जो है एंशिएंट साहित्य में। मैं आपसे क्विक चीज ये पूछना चाहूंगा, आपको क्या लगता है कि अब जो नई टेक्नोलॉजीज आई हैं जैसे गेमिंग है, और तो इसका हम कैसे इस्तेमाल जो है वो, जैसे छोटा भीम बड़ा पॉपुलर हुआ जो है, तो गेमिंग को हम और टेक्नोलॉजी को, क्योंकि टेक्नोलॉजी तो रहेगी, कैसे इस्तेमाल कर सकते हैं, what is the potential you see in terms of enhancing this legacy which we have?
मैं आपको एक ऐसा चीज बताना चाहूंगा तो आप यकीन नहीं करेंगे, मैंने कुछ 2 साल पहले एक गेम बनाया, लेकिन ये बोर्ड गेम बनाया मैंने, ये बोर्ड गेम जो है मोनोपोली आपने सुना होगा जो बहुत ही पॉपुलर है युवा पीढ़ी में, तो मोनोपोली का मैंने एक धार्मिक वर्जन बनाया। तो ये जो गेम है, द होल पर्पस ऑफ दिस गेम, इसको मैंने वी कॉल इट एवोल्यूशन, दैट्स द नेम ऑफ द गेम बेसिकली। इट्स अबाउट ये गेम जो खेलेगा उसको लॉ ऑफ कर्मा 100% सीख जाएगा। पहले जो मोनोपोली में होता है घर खरीदना होता है, तो यहां पे अलग अलग बॉडीज खरीदना होता है, एनिमल स्पीशीज, बर्ड स्पीशीज, ऐसा करके, एंड द गोल ऑफ लाइफ इज टू रीच ह्यूमन स्पीशीज। तो ऐसा करके हमने गेम बनाया हुआ है, और कुछ एक बॉक्स है जहां पे आप जाएंगे तो बुरा कर्मा का बॉक्स है, तो यू विल गो डाउन इन दिस सर्कल बेसिकली। तो ऐसे हमने बहुत सोच समझ के और इतनी अच्छी तरीके से प्लान करके ये गेम बनाया, और कर्मा इंस्टेड ऑफ मनी यू नो हम लोग कर्मा करेंसी यूज करते हैं। तो आपको एक एक स्पीशीज खरीदना है तो आपको इतना पैसा देना पड़ेगा, तो दैट मींस यू हैव टू स्पेंड दैट मच कर्मा है ना। तो हमने कर्मा बैंक अकाउंट बनाया, ऐसा बहुत सोच समझ के हमने बनाया। तो मेरा ये सोच था उस समय कि अगर गेम खेल के मजा भी आए और भगवत गीता का ज्ञान भी सीख ले तो दैट इज लाइक द यू नो बेस्ट ऑफ बोथ राइट। तो दैट इज द वे आई फेल्ट दैट वी शुड गो अहेड, एंड एज यू सेड यू नो अगर कोई एनिमेशन से कर सकता है यही चीज तो करना चाहिए, बिकॉज आज की तारीख में मोस्ट गेम्स टीच यू हाउ टू किल अदर्स, हाउ टू कॉम्पीट विद अदर्स एंड गो अहेड, बट द लॉ ऑफ कर्मा इज अबाउट योर ओन लाइफ। आपको मनुष्य बनना है या आपको मनुष्य जीवन से आगे बढ़ना है जीवन में, तो इट्स अबाउट योर लाइफ। सो द लॉ ऑफ कर्मा हेल्प्स यू कॉन्टेम्पलेट अबाउट हाउ यू कैन प्रोग्रेस रादर देन पुल अदर्स डाउन बेसिकली। सो दैट्स व्हाट आई फेल्ट यू नो वी कैन कॉन्ट्रीब्यूट लाइक दिस, एंड देयर आर सो मेनी गेम्स वी कैन क्रिएट if you just think in the right direction.
Thank you, Subhilash ji. It has been truly a pleasure and a privilege to have this conversation with you. And this is one of the most interesting conversations which I have had. I was last year also in Nagpur, in Orange Spirit Chapter. I go often, but this is one of the, in recent times, this is one of the most truly fulfilling conversation. And I hand it over to you, Apurva, and once again, want to thank all the organizers for providing us this opportunity to have this conversation.
Before Apurva speaks, let me just quickly thank Arunji for being here. It is such an honor and pleasure to be with you, sir. And I'm definitely going to connect with you a lot more offline, and we can do a lot of nice things together. And I would like to thank the Orange City Literary Festival for having invited me here and for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts with all the viewers. And thank you to all the viewers who are going to listen to this.
Thank you so much, sir. On behalf of Orange City Literature Fest, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for this session and knowledge shared with us. I would like to thank our supporting publisher, Jaco Publishing House, and Prabhat Prakashan for their cooperation. Thank you so much. Thank you.
20 years of existence. 2 universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions. A vision beyond.